Well, our parasha is Vayishlach, Vayishlach Yaakov Malachim. First of all, Rashi start in, right in the beginning and say, Malachim, angels, mamash. It's a real Malachim. And the question is, how does Rashi know? And it's basically Bereshit Rabbah. That he's quoting, and the Zohar start with his own explanation, and say that with Rabbi Yehuda, let's speak about the scripture about the sentence Ki malacha v'tzavelach lishmocha bechol derachecha, and he say that when a baby is being born to the world. Right away, Yetzer Hara, the bad inclination, Yetzer Hara, is start to be with him, start to fight with him. And that's what the scriptures say, Lapetach Chatat Rovetz. The sin is right in the open, right when. A person is being born lapetach chatat rovetz, and that's a yetzer hara. That's what we say in Hebrew, yetzer hara. But then the Zohar keep going, and he's saying that that the yetzer hatov, the good inclination, is on the right side of the heart, and the bad inclination is in the left side of the heart. There is like two rooms in the heart, and the bad, good inclination, Yetzer HaTov, is getting it, the consciousness is getting it right at the age of 13. And then they start to fight with one another to convince the Adam, the person, to do either good or evil. But then when a person comes to purify himself and to make a tshuva, then right away the bad inclination, Yetzer Hara, cannot fight him no more. And he basically have to help him out and to have an agreement with Yetzer HaTov together to keep the person way, and that's the explanation of the scripture. Ki malachav etzavelach lishmocha bechol derachecha. Ki malachav, because of your angels, is commanded to keep you with all your ways. That's the sentence, which means there is two angels, bad and good. The good inclination, bad inclination, came from two different angels that the Zohar is saying, Ramak, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero is saying that operating through the heart of a human being. And then Rabbi Elazar basically saying that when a person is he tried to explain the scripture about Yaakov Avinu. And he's saying, Ki malacha v'tzavelach lishmocha bechol derachecha. It's about Jacob. It's about our parasha. And he's saying, can you hear me? Is everything is okay?
I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt. There are people who are in the waiting room that are trying to get into the class, and they cannot get into the class.
Uh-huh, okay. So... okay, we're gonna work on it.
We're trying. I don't find it. Yudit. Wait, Zrinano. I don't find them.
I'll tell them to try again.
I don't see them. When they're trying to be invited, I don't see them.
Make sure that they're They're joining the English group.
She said, make sure that they are joining to the English group.
Then Rabbi Elazar is saying that it's this scripture is speaking about Jacob, and just like the scriptures say, "Vayakov halach ledarko veifgabu malachei Elohim," that Jacob went to his way, and the angels of Hashem met him. Okay, so he's saying that basically, when a person is holy, then angels are coming to protect him, just like Jacob. But the angels, but also the Shekhinah. The Shekhinah is coming to help him, to surround him, and the angels are coming with the Shekhinah together to keep the righteous person, which is Jacob. And what he's saying is, basically, there is a little contradiction between two different sentences. In one scripture, it says, "Vayishlach Yaakov malachim," which is many in a plural, and some other sentences are saying that basically, "Vayar malach Hashem elav belabat esh." Just like Jacob, one angel revealed himself to Moses in the bushes. So the question is, plural or singular? Why there is a contradiction between the two scriptures? Chone malach Hashem sviv l'reav. Chone malach Hashem, the angel of Hashem is in a singular, is chone, is parking like around Yireav to save them, so it sound like in singular. So the contradiction is being solved by saying, when it's in a singular, it's a Shekhinah. When it's in a plural, it's a malachim that coming with the Shekhinah to surround the righteous, which is Jacob here in our case. So that's from those angels that came to save Yaakov Avinu. He sent to Esav a real malachim mamash. And that's what Rabbi Yitzchak in the Zohar is saying. He's saying, "Patach Rabbi Yitzchak," open Rabbi Yitzchak, and he's saying to bring a proof to what we just say, "Vayishlach Yaakov malachim." Jacob is sending angels. "Hainu malachem marom," meaning malachem marom, angels from heaven. "V'amar k'tiv chonem malach Hashem siv l'ra'av echaletzem," which is sound like many angels. In a singular, and then Chazal is saying that in one place is the Torah is saying Malachav Yatzavelach, in another place it say Chone Malach Hashem Sivlerav. So in order to solve it, like I told you before, Rabbi Yitzchak is saying, I'm giving you a proof that basically it's impossible that the Torah contradict itself. And when the Torah speak about the singular malach, just like Moses in the bushes when Hashem reveal himself, malach Hashem reveal himself to him, it's in the singular. Okay, vayar malach Hashem elav. That's malach Hashem, angel of Hashem reveal himself to him. In a singular. So what we learn from that is that Yaakov Avinu was surrendered with angels to protect him, and the Shekhinah was with him. So why is it important? Because in the parasha, when we go on with the parasha, Yaakov Avinu say, katonti mikol ha-chasadim u-mikol ha-emet. I become little from all the grace that, and all the truth that Hashem is gave me, which in a simple way is saying, I don't deserve the grace of God, so much grace and so much truth that Hashem is putting upon me. But in according to the Zohar, is saying, no, right when Jacob went to take some cans and some tools in the darkness, when he went back to the way of Yabok, and he was along, he committed a sin, and he got punished because he was along in the darkness, and he's not supposed to go back along, and therefore the angels that surrounded him and the Shekhinah left him, and that's why he was saying, "Katonti mikol ha-chasadim mikol ha-emet." Now, you know, instead of going on with the parasha and with the Zohar, I would like to be a little more, to speak a little more in general, and to speak about our forefathers. What's the significant? What's so special about Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov? First of all, we have to know that they realize that they want to fix the ancient sin. Abraham Avinu, and let's start with him. He realized that all the generations before, that since creation till the time of Abraham, was committing sins before Hashem, which is Dor HaPalaga, the flood generation, the Sdom v'Amorah generation. They're always committing sin before Hashem and rebelling. And he was trying to fix the ancient sin of Adam and Eve, and he was, any place that he went, he was trying to plant a tree in order to see whether that was the place where heaven was. So that's why Hashem revealed himself to him, and he told him, oh, you want to fix the ancient sin of Etz Hadat, the tree of knowledge, let me show you where. Lech lecha. Lech lecha me'artzecha, me'malotecha, me'bet avicha, el ha'aretz asher lecha, to the land that I'll show you. And Hashem was telling him, go in order to see where your mission will be completed. You want to know where heaven was down on earth. It was basically in Har HaMoriah, and the dust that Hashem created Adam was under the altar in the temple of Jerusalem, under the altar of Beit HaMikdash, the temple of Jerusalem. So he told him to leave Haran and to go to Eretz Israel, and Avraham Avinu went to Be'er Sheva and he planted a tree. Why? Because he was searching the nature of the land, the nature of and the luck and the star of the place, to know which place was the right place to start to fix the ancient sin, the tree of knowledge, a sin that Adam and Eve committed. So Chazal is saying basically that Avraham Avinu, he fixed the nefesh. And with the Sarah, the nefesh of Adam v'Chava, Adam HaRishon, the ancient Adam. And Isaac and Rebecca, they fixed the Ruach. And Yaakov, Rachel v'Leah, they fixed the Neshama, they start with. And then the nation of Israel have to, throughout history, to complete the mission. Slowly and during the human history. Now they were about to complete the mission when they left Egypt, when they stood before Mount Sinai. If they didn't commit the golden calf sin right after, then they would have lived forever. And they didn't need to go with the plan of the second commandment, Luchot HaBrit, the Ten Commandments, or the second Ten Commandments. They had to go with the first Ten Commandments, which is infinitive life, and basically going back to the ancient time of heaven, and Moses would be the Messiah, and he will enter to the land of Israel as the Messiah and build the temple, and that's the end of the history, human history. But unfortunately, the Erev Rav that went out of Egypt with the nation of Israel, that Moses accepted without the permission of Hashem, Hashem kept silent when he heard Moses, that's what the Zohar say, begging him to take the Erev Rav, because they saw the glory and the power of Hashem and they want to worship Hashem. Hashem knew that no, they don't want to worship Hashem, they just go with the force. They thought, the Erev Rav thought that Moses is a greater professional witchcraft. So and they understood that he, since he defeat Pharaoh, he probably going to create a greater empire than Egypt. So they left Egypt not because they believed that Moses is a prophet and have a connection with Hashem, but Moses didn't understand that in the beginning, and he took them out of Egypt with him. And then when they committed the golden calf, then Hashem told Moses when he was in the Mount Sinai, go down the hill, because your nation, your that you took out of Egypt, which is the Erev Rav, committed the golden calf sin. Since they left Egypt, there was a big argument between the Erev Rav and the nation of Israel, the Israelite. When the Erev Rav claimed that Moses is not a prophet, and there is no such a thing, and there is no connection with the Creator, and they just they claimed that because they were behind, they were not under the cloud, the seven clouds that surrendered the nation of Israel, Ananei HaKavod, the honor cloud, okay, the seven clouds of that surrender Israel, the Israelite. They suffered the desert, and they had an argument with the nation of Israel. If they were type of an atheist people. Now, when they saw that Moses promised them that he will go down the hill of Mount Sinai after 40 days, and they didn't count it right, and they missed counting by 6 hours. So they start to claim that if Moses is a prophet and he spoke with Hashem as a prophet, the Creator cannot miss with 6 hours. So therefore, he must be under the time and space, and he's under this dimension, and he is not he's not a prophet. Because Hashem cannot miss with 6 hours counting. So therefore, they claim that they have a case. They have a case, so they made the golden calf, claiming basically the secret of it. They claim that probably there is a force, natural force, that Moses used, and that the Pharaoh didn't know much about the universe, and Moses knew a little better about the horoscope. And when in Egypt they believed in the the lamp, which is the horoscope of the lamp of Nisan, that is the oldest the luck of the stars, is he's giving the power to the other month. Other horoscopes 11 other horoscopes as the oldest, and they used to worship. Used to worship the lamp. They understood that probably it's a mistake, and probably Moses used something greater, and they start to look for something greater, and they decide that Chodesh Iyar, the month of Iyar that following Nisan, have a different horoscope, which is the ball, that's why they start to worship the ball, because they claim that he used a natural force, which is the ball and the balls, Taurus, yes, that the real oldest lack of the horoscope, and Pharaoh was mistaken by claiming that the lamp is the oldest one. So because they were kind of atheists, and then they use witchcraft to and that bull used to, or that Taurus used to speak and to say Anochi Hashem Elokecha, I am the Lord your God that took you out of Egypt, because they claim that that's the force that Moses used to take the people out of Egypt. And now we are under a different plan, because Moses broke the Ten Commandments, and he had to the first Ten Commandments, and now we are under the second Ten Commandments, and we have to go through four different type of exiles in order to fix the sin, because the nation of Israel, according to the Kabbalah, used to be in Edom, in Sdom v'Amorah. They used to be in the generation of the flood. They used to be in the generation of Nimrod with the ancient world order of Nimrod, and in order to fix the Dor Enosh, that Enosh generation that used to worship idols. So therefore, in order to fix those four generations, we have to go through Babylon, the Greek, the Persian, the Greek, and the Rome. Exile. Now, Avraham Avinu, which is our first forefather, when he decided, first of all, he was an astrologer. You say he knew about the stars. Yeah? Astrologist, and he was the astrologist of the ancient time, and all the kings and queens used to come to Abraham to ask him about the horoscope. He was professional, and he started to, like I told you, to dig and to try to find the nature of the land and the star of the land. And he realized that Eretz Yisrael, he couldn't really understand who is controlling, who is the minister, who is the angel that's controlling it. And therefore, Hashem revealed himself to him and told him, okay, you're searching. You want to know the land of Israel. You don't know who is controlling it. Who is the angel that's controlling it? Let me show you. Go leave your place and let me take you to the place where the Garden of Eden was, and where Adam was created, and where everything started, in order for you to start to fix the ancient sin. So when Avraham Avinu basically came to the land of Israel and start to hospitalize people in order to spread the faith of Hashem, and to give them food and drink in order to ask him to bless instead of paying money, to bless Hashem, and by that to spread the faith of Hashem instead of on the other side was Nimrod. Nimrod knew Hashem, and he exactly just like his name, he act like he want to rebel Hashem, to cover him from the consciousness of humanity, and to claim that he is a subject for worshiping, that he is the controlling the human history. Therefore, Avraham Avinu had a fight with Nimrod, and Nimrod sent him to he want to punish him, to set him on fire, and Hashem saved him. Now, our forefathers with Mesirut Nefesh start to fight in order to declare Hashem in the world. So, in the same way, Isaac, the son of Avraham Avinu, he also he was willing to sacrifice himself and to be slaughtered on the altar. In order what? Why is it? Why, at the age of 37, he was willing to give up his life? Why, Avraham Avinu, after having his child, and that he was so much in love with him, his only begotten son from Sarah, he was willing to sacrifice him? The point is that they knew one thing that we don't know. They knew that as soon that he will sacrifice his son on the altar, then that's it. By that he will be able to fix the ancient sin of the tree of knowledge, and all the human history are going back to heaven. No death, no more. And right away there is a resurrection. So he was willing to sacrifice his son in order to have him back in the Garden of Eden. And he knew it. But Hashem didn't allow that to happen. He held him in order to create humanity and to spread the name of Hashem in all the nations, and so in order that human history will continue. And in the same way with Jacob, now we don't understand if Lavan in our parasha, in parasha, the next parasha before, parasha Toldot, he knew Hashem. Even in our parasha, he's saying your forefathers, the father of the God of Abraham and Isaac, spoke with me last night, Emesh, and he told me not to talk with you bad and or evil, good or bad, because probably Lavan could have the capability of harming Jacob, but Hashem, God of Abraham and Isaac, spoke with me, so he know the God of Abraham and Isaac, what his problem, why he didn't believe in him, what's his point. And the same thing we can see when Jacob came to search for a woman, and he found Rebecca, and Eliezer Eved Avraham, when he was sent to bring a woman for his son, for Isaac, Avraham and Betuel, what they were saying, Me'Hashem yatzah hadavar. Oh, we know that it's from Hashem. So they knew the Hashgacha, they knew Hashem. So what is their problem? Their belief was, they believe in, not monotheism, but there is a God of Nahor, and there is a God of Abraham and Isaac, and there is many gods. And so that's what they thought, that they were polytheistic. Therefore, he could have, but the fight, the real fight was that Jacob was want to reveal the glory of Hashem through the nation of Israel and through holiness. And Lavan and Nahor and Bilam, which is his grandson of Lavan, want to reveal the name of Hashem through, I would say, impurity and through the Gentiles. And that's what that was the fight between Bilam and Moses. That was the fight between Jacob and Laban. The question is how to reveal the glory of Hashem in the world, whether through the nation of Israel and the holiness and or purity or the dark side, which Laban used to believe in. But they knew Hashem. When we speak about our generation, our poor generation, there is many, many people that don't understand even that they don't even believe in God's existence. But in the ancient time, they knew Hashem. They just have a fight of how to reveal the glory of Hashem into the to bring it down to the earth and to the world. Now, there was also the agenda of Nimrod and Pharaoh and Nebuchadnezzar. And if you will go on, it's the agenda of the New World Order, which is the agenda of Nimrod and Pharaoh and the same agenda. And since the ancient time, whom fight that agenda? Abraham was fighting Nimrod, and Moshe Rabbeinu was fighting Pharaoh, and Daniel, Shlomo, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah was fighting and Nebuchadnezzar. And even the fight between King David David and Goliath was about that same thing. Now, if you're going to ask people here in Israel, soldiers, who is our real enemy? What do you think that they will say? They will say the Arabs. Even, you know, the most of the population here in Israel, they will say the Arabs. But that's not what the Torah revealed to us in our parasha and in Parashat Toldot. They revealed to us something completely different. There is a fight between Esav and Jacob. Esav is not the Ishmaelite. Ishmael is have a different entity, and Esav have a different entity. And the Zohar start to tell us that fight is in the mikro and the makro. It's not only in the world, it's also inside a human being, inside his heart. When Esav, al itenina min ha'adom ha'adom hazeh, he liked the red soup. He's representing the blood, which representing the left side of the heart that have a blood and interested in the present life, interested in to enjoy life.
איך? אוקיי.
למעשה, יש, there is a question about Yaakov Avinu. He's supposed to fix the soul of Adam Harishon, and the question is, he's in the Parashat Toldot, he was lying to his father, and the Torah say Titen Emet LeYaakov, that give the truth to Jacob. Avraham Yaakov Avinu represent the truth? Is he deceived his father? The Zohar deal with that issue by saying that Yaakov Avinu was the incarnation of Adam Harishon, of Adam, and Rebecca, his mother, was Chava Imenu. And Esav representing the snake. He represents the snake. And now, since the in ancient time, in Gan Eden, the Garden of Eden, the snake deceived Adam and Eve and brought a curse upon them instead of blessing, and he took the blessing out of Adam and Eve. So in the same way, in the same manner, we have to kebol okach polto, just like in in Passover, before Passover, when we went to make our tools kosher in the kitchen. So the way that the dish is swallowing the chametz, in the same way we have to use it in order to pull out his chametz from the dish. In the same way, we have to deceive the snake, and therefore Rivka is saying to Jacob, "Alaiker latchabni, the curse is upon me. Don't worry." Jacob was saying, "What if my father will reveal that I'm Jacob, I'm not Esau, and I'll bring upon me a curse instead of blessing?" So Rebecca is responding to him, and she's saying, "Don't worry, the curse is upon me. I brought upon you when we were in heaven. I brought upon you a curse by committing a sin when the snake seduced Eve to eat from the fruit. So therefore, and then I gave you to eat, and therefore through me, we have to fix the ancient sin by and don't worry. I want to bring the blessing upon you through me. Therefore, listen to me and obey to what I'm commanding you to dress up the clothing of Esau and go to your father to ask to take the blessing with a deception, because midah keneged midah. It's a midah keneged midah. You say how to say midah keneged midah in English. A character, in the same manner that the snake used to behave, you have to do the opposite. In the same way, Daniel did in the time of Nebuchadnezzar, when he asked to kiss the statue of Nebuchadnezzar. So Nebuchadnezzar was very happy. Well, Daniel, which just went from the cage of lion, he want to kiss my statue. He gave him a letter to climb to kiss his statue, while all the nations around the world, because he used to control the world, sent two representatives to bend before the statue of Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel was climb on the letter to kiss the statue to pull out the tzitz of the Kohen Gadol that was in his mouth. That's why that statue used to talk and to say, "Anochi Hashem Elokecha Asher Otzaticha Mitzrayim." I'm the Lord your God that took you out of Egypt. Therefore, Daniel want to take what the klipa, what the dark side swallow, in order to. He did exactly what Jacob was doing by deceiving Nebuchadnezzar. Jacob was, kind of deceiving the klipa, deceiving the dark side and the snake, which is Esau. But in our parasha, there is even greater deception that not many people realize unless you study Zohar. Zohar say that the fact that Jacob was bending before Esau when Esau came with 400 soldiers to kill him. When Jacob act that way like a servant, and he bent seven times before Esau, if Esau knew what he was doing, he would prefer to kill himself at that moment. Why? And but he didn't realize he was giving him the control to control control him and to control the world during the exile time, but he took from him the control for infinitive time, for the end of time. And Esav didn't realize that, because he didn't know, because his inclination and intention is to live the moment, the red, the blood. Al itenina min adom adom azeh. He prefer the moment over infinity. And so what Jacob was doing, he bent before him in order to show him that the blessing of his father didn't come true. That he's not controlling his brother, he's being controlled by. So by that, then Esav couldn't even hate him no more, because he realized that the blessing that he's hating him for didn't come true. Which, the blessing of Jacob was the blessing that Isaac blessed Jacob. He told him, "You're gonna be a lord, or you're gonna be a ruler over your brother." And now his brother coming from Lavan, and he's bending before him, and he is bending seven times and giving him a lot of presents, and he thought to himself, that's what the Zohar say, if he is so strong and he can be a ruler over me, how come that he is sending me so many presents and he is acting like a servant? Obviously, the blessing that my father blessed him didn't come true. So he become happy, and he could overcome his hatred to Jacob, and he could come and hug him. The Midrash say that he thought about killing him by biting him in his neck, but at that real moment, a mercy that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, a mercy Hashem put a mercy in his heart for that same moment. And then he kissed him instead of biting him. Why? Because he also realized that, he was confused that if, and also the Rashi is saying that, Vahili Shov Vechamo, he was saying, I was living with Lavan. And the question is, you were living, why do you have to tell him that you used to live with Lavan for 20 years? And the answer of Rashi and the Bereshit Rabba and the Zohar is, look, you know and I know that Lavan is the greater witchcraft in the world. And Lavan and Esav was intimidated by Lavan. Otherwise, he could have chased Jacob to kill him during those 20 years and go to Lavan to kill him. No, no, but he was afraid from Lavan, because Lavan used to take the scale of the oldest son and to kill the oldest son and to take the scale in order to worship his avodah zara, his idols. So, and he was the oldest, so he was afraid from Lavan, and he knew that Lavan had a lot of power of witchcraft, that he could even made him disappear from this world and from the upper world, that he won't be anywhere, not dead and not alive. That's what the Zohar say. And that's why Hashem revealed himself to Lavan to tell him, don't speak with Jacob, bad or good, because he knew that through his talk, not according to his action, because according to his action, the tribes were much stronger than Lavan. But when Lavan was chasing Jacob and running after Jacob, to catch him. He didn't want to fight him because he knew that he cannot defeat Jacob, but because Jacob is much stronger with his children, with the tribes, he knew that he had a different power, the power of witchcraft, that he could made him disappear from this world and from the upper world, not to be alive or dead, not to be anywhere. And that's why Hashem, and the fact that Hashem spoke with him and revealed himself to him to tell him, to warn him, it's like a compellable evidence of the Torah that Lavan have that power, and therefore we have to, after any prayer, any shachrit prayer, morning prayer, we say the 10 different things that we have to memorize. One of them is the grace of Hashem that what Lavan was Bilam was thinking about Balak was thinking about to curse Israel, and God turned it to blessing, because Bilam was the grandson of Lavan. It's the same Bet Midrash. It's the same school of witchcraft school. And that's in our parasha. It's saying that our greatest enemy is not Ishmael. The Parashat Toldot and the Parashat Vayishlach saying that we didn't learn history much, especially the Israeli, our generation, because if we knew exactly what the fight is all about, it's between Esau and Jacob, in the Mikro, in the Makro, inside the human heart, and in the world between the Western civilization with the Christian religion of Esau and Jacob, which is a Judaism. Don Yitzchak Abarbanel is saying in his book Yeshuot Meshicho, that's the name of the book, is saying that Sancheriv is already mixed the world. He mixed the population of the world. So who is being considered to be Esav? Who is being considered to be Ishmaelite? He's saying that it doesn't go by the biology no more. Only the nation of Israel, you know, they kept their ancestors, but the other nations were mixed. So therefore, whomever believes in Christianity is being considered Edomite, is being considered following Esav. Anyone that following Muhammad, following Islam, is Ishmaelite. And the entity of his soul is being attracted to those places according to his to where his soul is supposed to be, anyways. So therefore, we have to know that when we want to talk about our life and our generation, then the Zohar in Bereshit Kav Gimel, and the second page is saying that Jacob saw with his holy spirit, he saw that our generation, Jacob saw the Dochak Agalut, the last exile of the end of time, and that's why he was saying Vayira Yaakov Meod Vayetzer Lo. He was worried. Jacob was worried, and why? Because he saw the Dochak, he saw the misery of the nation of Israel in the last exile. That's why he, when he divide his camp to three parts, and he put in the beginning he put the all the servant and Bila and Zilpa and their children in the front, and then he put Leah and his children right after, and then Rachel and Yosef in the last camp, when he divided them to three. Then the Zohar say that it represents the end of time. There is three different groups in the nation of Israel by the end of time, in our time. The first group is people, simple people that going to work every day, and balebatim, they're balebatim, because they can support the people that studying Torah, but they don't study much Torah. So therefore, they're being represented by the, you know, the servant group, the first group that Hashem putting in the front. The second group is the people that studying Torah, but they don't study they don't dig to study the real meaning of the secrecy of Judaism. They study the simplicity of the Torah, and they don't really connect it to the great depth of the Torah. So they study the simple explanation of the Torah. And the other, the Rachel and Yosef, which is the third group, is the people that they're dealing with the secrecy of the Torah, learning Kabbalah, and they consider to be the highest, the soul of the nation of Israel, which is a nefesh, ruach, and neshama. It's an allegory that being used by the Zohar when he speak about the story of the Parashat HaShavua, but then he made an allegory about the end of time and about our time. To say that basically the same thing going to happen by the end of time. Now, I want you to know that HaRamban and many other Rishonim, when they speak about our generation, they study the reality in a different way than we look about our own generation. But they don't view our generation the way we view our generation. They view it differently. They know exactly what the Torah is saying, not like us, that thinking that we're dealing with the Arabs the most. They thought that we are dealing with Esav, which is, and his son, and his grandson, Amalek. And I don't know if you can realize and see that we are dealing with that nowadays the most, which is the New World Order, and we're dealing with the culture of the Western civilization, with the culture, you know, that's Milchemet Gog, the war of Gog and Magog, the spiritual war of Gog and Magog, that each soul is supposed to cross the darkness of nowadays and to choose Hashem over the materialistic life, to choose the right path and to be saved. But Ramban is saying that the Messiah will go to the Pope in Vatican, and he will tell him, "Let my people go." And when we read such a thing, the Ramban, which is, you know, the greater Mekubal of the ancient time of 850 years ago, when he was saying that, the question is, how he understood our generation, how he understood the events of our generation. What, the Pope in the Vatican have any? The Pope of the Vatican have a great power over? Over the nation of Israel? What, he will be the Pharaoh of the end of time? Is Rome going to be the Egypt of the ancient time? And basically, what he's saying is, yes, that's what he's saying. He's saying that the Messiah will go just like Moses went to Pharaoh and told him, "Let my people go." Koh amar Hashem, Hashem was told me to tell you, let my people go. In the same way, will do the Messiah when he will go to the Pope in the Vatican and tell him, Koh amar Hashem, let my people go. And the Pope will tell him, I don't know Hashem. And the question is, how come the Pope will tell him, I don't know Hashem? He is a Christian, he is a Catholic, and the Catholic, they're supposed to know the Bible, they're supposed to know the story of the Bible and to believe in the and the Father, the way they say they believe in the Father, the God of the Bible. Yes, but what we see nowadays, we understand that the Vatican is being conquered by the group of the Freemasonry, and we know that what they believe. They do believe, people think that the Vatican is a Catholic, but in the 2013 there was some changes in the Vatican, and the Pope Benedictus the 16th left the position on his own, and a new Pope entered, which is Jorge Bergoglio. He called himself Franciscus the First, and he is he doesn't believe in Catholicism. He believes in Luciferian doctrine, and therefore that the first Pope ever in the Vatican, not from the White Order, but from the Black Order, from the Jesuit Order that believe in Lucifer. So therefore, if the next Pope or him himself, who knows, we don't know when, but if the Messiah will come to the Pope to tell him, let ko amar Hashem, Hashem say, let my people go, he will tell him, I don't know Hashem, because he believe in Lucifer. So you got to understand that Haramban, we have now approved nowadays that Haramban 815 years ago knew exactly what he was talking about. We are the one that don't exactly know what he meant, but they knew exactly that we have a problem, not that the big conflict is not with the Arabs, but rather with Isa and with the culture of the Western civilization. And I just want to tell you that Galia Raza, it's a book of Marcho, which is a student of Ari HaKadosh from Tzfat, was saying that in the same way that in the ancient time, in the generation of the flood, the land of Israel, there was no flood, but the entire world there was a flood. The same way, by the end of time, there will be a flood of fire, and the flood of fire will take over the place of the entire world, but not in Israel, in the same way, because Israel will be the ark, just like in the Noah time, an ark to be saved with from the flood of fire. But Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai in the Ramchal, in the book of Adir Bamarom, is saying that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai created the ark by the Zohar, and whomever that enter to the word, to the teva, in Hebrew teva could be also a word, which is a teva, that when you enter to the word of the Zohar, which when you enter to the teva, to the ark, then you're being saved. So in order for us to be saved, we have to, from the Chavle Mashiach and the fight between and all the event of the ancient of the last day time, then we have to enter to the words of the Zohar in order to be saved. That's what Adir Bamarom, Ramchal, is saying, and we have to pay attention to that, because it's a that's the way the Adir Bamarom. It's a very important book of secrecy of the Ramchal. That's the way he started the book, by saying, Adir Bamarom, in the beginning of the book, right in the beginning, when you open the again. I couldn't hear what you were saying. Hello? Oh, okay. So there is another punchline that I would like to say, and we're going to end the lecture with that, is the forefather of Achida. If you heard about Achida, Rabbi David Chaim Azulai, he was saying in his book Chesed LaAbraham that when the Messiah will come, then if the redemption will be by judgment, not by grace, then only 7,000 people that didn't bend to the Baal will meet the Messiah while they are alive. They will not need to die in order to meet the Messiah. And when the Messiah will resurrect the other righteous people by the time of resurrection, then the other righteous that came, that rose erected from the death, will ask him, what's the difference between us? Why we had to die and they had to, and the other 7,000 people could meet you with avoiding death? And he will answer, those people didn't care about money, didn't care about gold and silver. And the question is, what kind of a gold and silver, what's the gold and silver is? 7,000 didn't bend to the Baal, and then gold and silver, what's the connection between them? And the answer is that unfortunately we have to understand that the golden calf is a sin that exists in our own days. And people still were worshiping gold and silver and still worshiping the golden calf. And therefore, they cannot choose right, because they're bending to, to a government that and worship without Hashem, just like the scripture saying, "Hemich isuni belo el," they made me mad because they created a kingdom with no Hashem. I will make them jealous with no nation, which is the Palestinian. That can be going naval achisem. What's going naval? Goy, Gentile that naval, that corrupted, that can scream Allah but stab you in the back with a knife, which is can murder against the word of Hashem, but they scream the name of Hashem while they're committing the sin. And basically, we have to understand, we want the kingdom of Malchut Shamayim, of heaven. We have to ask for the temple of Jerusalem. We have to ask for the kingdom of David HaMelech. That's what Amar Rabbi Shimon ben Menasya, Amar Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai. If Israel will not ask for three things, they will never see a sign of redemption. They have to ask for Malchut Shamayim, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of King David, and the temple of Jerusalem. So we have to understand, we cannot really ask such a thing from our bottom of the heart if we want to go back to our ordinary life under the Erev Rav control. We have to realize that we want to leave Egypt. We want to really leave Egypt and be Mamlechet Kohanim v'Goy Kadosh, and to be redeemed by Hashem, and to go to the land of promise, which is in spiritual manner, which is the redemption and the era of the Messiah, and not stay in the regular life and go back to our regular life under the control of the Erev Rav. The same thing Agon Mivilna is saying. He's saying something very spicy, I'd say. He's saying that the Erev Rav is our greatest enemy. And why? Because usually Erev Rav is supporting the Malachite. The same thing in our generation. Same thing with in the Third Reich, and it's in the same thing in the Fourth Reich, unfortunately. The Third Reich, I'm saying, when we speak about the time of the Second World War, when the Judenrat used to help out the Nazis and to convince people to climb to the train for a good trip, for a better life, and to enter to the Gaschamber to have a good shower. They deceived the population of Israel. In the same way, that's the nature of the Erev Rav. They operate with the power. Always they go with the power, just like when they left Egypt and they thought that Moses was a greater witchcraft than Pharaoh. They didn't believe that he's a prophet. They didn't believe that he speak with Hashem. They just thought that if Pharaoh can create a great empire like Egypt, then Moses probably will create a greater empire better than Pharaoh. So they went with the power. That's why they committed sin. They always convinced the Israelite to commit sin against Hashem because they didn't believe in Hashem. They just believe in nature. In the same way, by the end of time, when they will see that the new world order and have a power, they will not go with the nation of Israel, and they will not be reliable to the need of their people, but rather they will accept the concept of the plan of the new world order to create one world order, just like in Dora Palaga, just like in Nimrod time. The same way by the end of time. That's what it will repeat itself. Till the time of the Messiah will come, when the Messiah will come, and just like Daniel is prophesizing in the book of Daniel, that a little stone that will be disconnected from a mountain and be fallen on the statue of Nebuchadnezzar on its feet. And then that world human control of human history will become a dust that will spread all over the world, and the control will be given to the holy nation, the nation of Israel. So we hope, Be'ezrat Hashem, that soon the Messiah will come. And, you know, in our parasha, I don't know if you know, when Esav is telling Jacob that we're going to hold and go together, let's go together. I told him, no. I have a children here. I have to go slowly. You go on, go to Har Esav, to the Mount of Esav, and I'll come afterward. The question is when Jacob planning to go to Har Esav? It's the end of time. By the end of time, when the Messiah will come, the Messiah son of Joseph, Messiah son of David, ve'alu Moshe'im me'ar Tzion, two Moshe'im lishpot et Har Esav, to judge the Mount of Esav, v'ayta l'Hashem amlucha, b'yom ahu yashem echad ushmo echad. And that day, the kingdom will be to Hashem. I thank you for listening. I'm going to end up the lecture for this week. And if you have any questions, I'm willing to answer. There's some questions. Okay, to you know to Can please go on. Okay.
And so I want to know what is the best nekuda, what's the best, you know, direction to, because these are families, they're getting together in the park, mm-hmm. and it's all age children. I've been directed to aim my lessons to the older ones, and the younger ones will do it. I'm doing a lot of hands-on projects and things, but what is the message? What is the message to get to the children that they... Them, because I call it Geula Academy, and these are the children that are going to be Be'ez Hashem, you know, welcoming Mashiach.
Yeah, we have to tell them that despite what we see, you know, right before dawn, there is a big dark. The night is become the darkest right before dawn. And anything that we see bad now, going, you know, society and human society become corrupted, you know, and we see everything around us collapsing. We have to understand that that's the big sign that soon the Messiah will come to create new civilization, and we don't supposed to be afraid. We're supposed to take the fear and to make transformation to emunah and bitachon, confidence and faith in Hashem. And we have to understand that that's what we have to work on in order to be included in the redemption. So we have to see, that's the sign that the Gemara is saying by the end of Gemara Sota, Masechet Sota, that we expected that the corruption will take place all over, and there is nothing to rely on and accept Hashem, and here the time come, and many generations want to be instead of us. We have the zchuyot, the right to be in the most important generation, that the Messiah will come to redeem the world. And Baal Shem Tov is saying that, okay, we are considered to be a list of all the generations, but soon everything going to turn over and we're going to be the most important generation of the world, because the Messiah will come in our own generation. And if Adam HaRishon committed a sin, and in our generation will come the Messiah that will fix the ancient sin, so everything going to turn over and we're going to be the most important generation. We are about to see the miracles coming back. All the miracles that was in the desert will come back in the end of time. All the plagues that was in Egypt will occur again. Because that's what Rabbeinu Bechaya is saying in Parashat Bo, that he have a proof from the prophets, from the Treasar, that the Edomite will have a 10 plagues, just like in Egypt, in the same way, blood, you know, frogs, all those plagues will occur again against Rome. Rome, it's a concept. It's not a Rome in Europe. It's also a Rome in Europe, but it's a concept. It's all the Edomite empire all over the world. So we have to understand. But the Pharaoh of it, it's the Pope in the Vatican, and we are not talking about the white Pope that we see, Jorge Bergoglio. He's a prophet. The real Pope, the evil Pope, the black Pope, is hiding, and there is such a thing, and he is the head of the mafia of the world. And yes, the Midrash is saying that his name will be Armilus. Now, it sounds like, you know, Benedictus, Armelus, all the names that we are really familiar with. The name is matching, even by sound and even by the suffix, the expectation of the Midrash. What we have to say to the children is we're soon going to be in the time of the Messiah, and the world will change, and when the time will change, it's time of the Messiah. Okay, slowly and surely there will be no hospitals, no need for hospitals, no need for jail, no need for immorality or for suffer, or even no sorrow and death by the end, but toward the resurrection, to speak positively about the good and the goodness of Hashem that is soon to come. Erev Tov. Okay, Erev Tov.
Thank you for this amazing shiur. I'd like to add some points that make impression to me, especially for the commentary of Rabbi Vali, also in the Horda Tara and our Perasha by Yisrael, the Vayetz. Some connections. One is that says there that when Yaakov was born, was his kind of Ekev, the hill of Esav, his intention, the spiritual intention, was to push him, to push the Klipa, to take it far away, not to pull.
Mm-hmm.
So, because says in the Haftarah, from the Beten, even from when he was in the womb, Kadosh Baruch Hu provide to him all the spiritual powers that he needs to overcome the challenges that arise in the future.
And
when we come to the events that we have in our parasha, we see something very interesting. That in the beginning, Yaakov he's in he approached, he was visited from a lot of angels, and the Shekhinah, that is the one that very nice, we said. But he saw that the Kadosh Baruch Hu, he prepared something very, very great for him. In the beginning, his intention was to send them the angels to destroy all the building of the other side, of the south. But after that, through Ruach HaKodesh, he changed mind and understood. And this is what we told him, no, the time is not the right time. Don't push the time. For this reason, he said to send the angels to appease him, to say to my Lord. So all this was prepared from above, what happened. And the continuation, at night, an angel, as the angel of Esav, he said to Kadosh Baruch Hu to fight with Yaakov before the meeting that has Esav in the morning. So in this particular fight, because Yaakov Avinu, he kept the brit, Samar, the tabrit, he was pure and perfect in his avodah, and he fulfilled his avodah of birur, say, with this small jazz, it looks like that. He overcome the angel that is the angel of Esav, the Tsar of Esav, the prince of Esav, in heaven, in this particular way that he was crying, the angel in the morning, who's the Samech Men, right?
Yes.
The Samech Men. He was crying and begged Yaakov to give him permission to go up to heaven.
Son.
And in this conversation, Yaakov, he took out from him his submission to him. Right? That to bless him and that he will be submitted to him. Mm-hmm. But what happened in the story? Now, says in the Aftara, he speaks, the angel spoke with double tongue, because it was the Samech Mem, mm-hmm. like the snake. And he said, this will happen, that means I will be Sinigor, not Katigor, Katigor to you, Sinigor.
Mm-hmm.
But it was in his words a precondition, right? The precondition is, if your descendants, during the history, they stay connected to Kadosh Baruch Hu, they keep the Torah, the Mitzvot, and they stay in holiness. If not, I'm not bound to this.
Mm-hmm.
But when I'm Israel, they keep the brit, they stay connected to Kadosh Baruch Hu in holiness, then this angel, according to his promise, and is obligated in front of Kadosh Baruch Hu, to be synagogue to Am Yisrael, not category. Just to be our category and cause all these big problems, the time that was we abandoned the power of Kadosh Baruch Hu. Thank you.
Yeah, that's that. You're right, but that's only during the exile time, because what the Zohar is saying, by presenting himself as a servant of Esav and bending before him seven times, he basically gave him the control during the exile time, and he took from him the control by the end of time and for infinitive, and therefore the Sanegor Kategor, the devil will be Sanegor Kategor during the exile time, according to our action, if we are righteous or not, but not by the end of time and not for infinity. That's something that. And another thing, the Zohar is saying that katonti mikol hachasadim mikol haemet, that the angels, why katonti? Why I become smaller? Because all the camp of angels that came with the Shekhinah left him when he went to take the cans over the river. And why is it? The Zohar is saying because Hashem wants Jacob to defeat the angel of Esav along with no help. If there were some other angels and the Shekhinah by him, then they would have helped him, so he himself couldn't defeat him. But God gave him the power, empower him, with no angels and no Shekhinah, to him himself to defeat the angels of Esav so that he can get it for infinitive, to have the control over him for infinitive. Baruch Tia.
There's a question in the chat from Miri Shalom. For those living in the Geula, is it okay to stay there, or do you recommend making Aliyah as soon as possible, also considering the difficulties getting to Eretz Yisrael?
Yes, okay. Since we spoke about a parasha, we didn't speak about actualia and about what's going on nowadays. But okay, let me tell you what I recommend. People that I recommend to make an aliyah to Eretz Israel. I definitely recommend that. Why? Because we know. I'll tell you what. It's a little story, and we're going to end by that. I asked a big admor of Serat Vizhnitz, is chatan of Rabbi Serat Vizhnitz, Rabbi Kornreich. I asked him, you say that Rabbi Noam Elimelech, which you consider him as a rabbi of all rabbis, he said that he was able to wipe out the judgment of Chevle Mashiach. During the Chevle Mashiach, he was able to sweeten the judgment. So in what mean? Since the time of Noam Elimelech 250 years ago, there was a Holocaust, there was many, many wars like Yom Kippur War and the Six Days War, and many other wars. How, in what way you believe that he was able to sweeten the judgment of end of time? And he told me, no, you don't understand. He was able to sweet the judgment, to fix the judgment of the end of time only during the 9 months before the coming of the Messiah, the birth, the deliverance of Chevle Mashiach, and only in the land of Israel. There will be a huge Holocaust all over the world, which happening now. I don't know if you're realizing. Some people realizing by, you know, the injection that they're doing. It's an injection. It's not exactly a vaccine. But some people don't realize yet, unfortunately. They'll realize in the future. I say that it's an action of the Fourth Reich already. But the point is that the point is that he was able to sweep the judgment only in the land of Israel, and only during those 9 months when the war Holocaust will take place. So you ask me if you need to make an aliyah. I prefer to say yes. Do you think that you see what's going on here in Israel, and you're being intimidated by that? No, don't be intimidated by that. You have to understand one thing. Here in the land of Israel, there will be the greatest fear. Why is it? Because it's a part of the God plan. So, because the Erev Rav, they think, you know, naturally. They don't think, they don't believe in Hashem. They don't believe in the Bible. They don't believe in the prophecy and the prophets. They don't have confidence in Hashem. They don't hold to the prophecies. So they will think logically, if here is the most dangerous place, let me run away from the land of Israel, take my luggages and run away from the land of Israel. And that's the way God separating the Erev Rav from the faithful nation and the holy nation that will stay here and hold to the prophecies of the Bible and the promises of Hashem. So don't be intimidated by what's going on here in Israel, because here's a land that Hashem controlling it. The eye of Hashem is here upon the land of Israel from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. And we don't have to be intimidated by the plan of the Illuminati or the plan of the Freemason or the shadow government. No. We don't fear the New World Order. We fear Hashem. If you fear Hashem, you don't fear anything else. Okay? If you fear one, you don't fear anyone. And the one that you should fear is Hashem only. So do I recommend to make an aliyah? Yes. Is it difficult? Probably. Is it the most right thing to do? Yes, definitely. I thank you for listening. And Bezrat Hashem, next week we're going to meet again. If you're interested.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome.